Hello guys, my name is Mayank and today we'll be learning normalization in database management systems. So basically, what is normalization? So normalization is the process of decomposing or breaking down a big database into small relations or small tables so that we can better understand what these tables are convey to say, like what are these tables basically for. So it is basically the decomposition of unsatisfactory or bad relations by breaking up their attributes into smaller relations. Now, a properly normalized database should have the following characteristics. Number one, it should have scalar values in each fields. Number two, there should be absence of redundancy. Number three, minimum use of null values. And number four, minimal loss of information. Now, why do we normalize? So basically, the most important reason why we normalize is to avoid redundancy. Redundancy means when there are multiple occurrences of the same data or multiple copies of the same data. So we don't want that. Now we don't want that because that leads to storage, you know, more storage space is acquired by these redundant information. So a lot of storage space is wasted and the data is not consistent. So that is why we don't want redundancy in our data and that is why we normalize. We also normalize to avoid update or delete anomalies, which we'll learn later, and also to avoid the loss of information. Information, of course, is a very important factor for any company or any organization working with databases. And so, to protect the information and so that the tables or the databases convey the right kind of information, it is important that we normalize these tables. The different forms of normalizations. Now basically there are six types of normalizations that we know of. The first one is first 1NF, that is first normal form. Then we have the second NF or the second normal form, the third NF, the third normal form, BCNF or the Boy Scout normal form, 4NF, fourth normal form, and 5NF, that is the fifth normal form. Before we go on to what these kinds of normalizations are, we must learn what functional dependencies are. Now, if one set of attributes in a table determines another set of attributes in the table, then the second set of attributes is said to be functionally dependent on the first set of attributes. So what this basically means is, see, suppose if we have a, let's see this through an example. Okay, so suppose if we keep a track of employee email addresses and we only track one email address for each employee. So suppose each employee is identified by the unique employee number. So then we say that there's a functional dependency of email address on employee number, because every employee's details, for example, his email ID or his email address is identified through his employee number. So we can say that employee number determines email address. So then we say that employee number determines email address. So that is how it's a functional dependency. All right. So now we can see another example. For example, here we have four columns: employee number, employee email, employee first name, employee last name. So here we have a few, we've taken a few examples of, you know, of employee number and all these employee email IDs, employee first name, employee last names. We have a few data out here. So as you can see, since employee number is the primary key, so it must determine, every primary key must determine the other attributes, right? So it is very clear that the employee number cannot be null because the primary key value is not null. Okay, so this employee number determines all the other fields. So you can say that the employee number is the primary key, and thus it functionally determines all the other fields. So here we have shown it in three parts: the employee number determines the employee email ID, the employee number determines the employee first name, and the employee number determines the employee last name. So these three dependencies for this table must exist. If these dependencies don't exist, then we say that the functional dependency is not correct. Okay. So I think I should repeat again, because employee number is the primary key. A primary key value cannot be null. So also a primary key is supposed to determine all the other values. Okay. So for example, employee email can be null for a given pair of data. For example, for John, for the first name John and employee last name Doi, the employee email could not be given. So employee email cannot be used as a functional dependency because we cannot use employee email to determine the other fields because it is not a primary key. Okay, but we can use employee number to determine the other fields because it is a primary key and its values, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, these values can never be null. So since they can never be null, we can effectively use them to determine the other field values. So here we are showing three different ways that we might see FDs in. For example, here is the normal way where employee number determines employee email, employee number determines employee first name, employee number determines employee last name, employee number determines, then there's a tree like structure where we do it, where we show all the three parts that employee number determines. And this one, this is a table format where we show it through arrows. For example, employee number determines these three fields. So here what we're trying to show is that employee number is determining employee email, employee first name and employee last name. Thus, there's a functional dependency from employee number to employee email, functional dependency from employee number to employee first name, and a functional dependency from employee number to employee last name. Clear? Next. Now we move on to the different types of normal forms. So the first one is the first normal form, also known as 1NF. N stands for normal and F stands for form. Okay. So the rule for the first normal form is it allows only single atomic indivisible attribute values in one cell, which means that every cell should contain only a single value, and every column must have the same type of attributes. Okay, these two conditions are very important. Now normally most tables are generally in 1NF forms, okay, and they never ask you in an examination to convert to 1NF or give the 1NF form of the table, because usually tables are in 1NF form and you have to convert them to the other forms. But for this example, we'll show you that some tables are not in 1NF form and you need to change them to the first 1NF form. Okay, for example, in this table is not in 1NF form because for the last name Smith, the first name has three attributes, three values: Peter, Mary and John. Okay, and for the second name also we have two attributes here. Now the rule is every cell should have single atomic and indivisible attribute values. Okay, so therefore we need to change this, and after normalization into 1NF, the table becomes something like this. So for each value we have one cell. Okay, so this is how we normalize it into one first normal form. Since we had multiple attributes here, we change it into single attributes in one cell. Alright, so this is normalization into 1NF. Now we want to move on to the second form, that is the second normal form, also known as 2NF. Now, a relational schema R is in second normal form or 2NF if every non-prime attribute A in R is fully functionally dependent on the primary key. So basically here the concepts of functional dependencies and primary key are used, which we will be seeing in the next slides. So what is a prime attribute basically? So now a prime attribute is basically an attribute that is a member of the primary key K. Okay, so for example, if a table has one primary key, then the prime attribute will be that primary key. If a table has more than one primary key, for example, it has two primary keys, then both the attributes together will form the prime attribute of that table. Okay, now what is full functional dependency? So functional dependency Y tends to Z, where removal of any attribute from Y means that functional dependency does not hold anymore, is known as full functional dependency. Okay, so basically in second normal form, what we are trying to do is we are trying to remove the partial dependency, as you're going to see later. Okay, so now what a partial dependency is. So for example, as I said, a table can have either one primary key or more than one primary key, like we call the candidate keys. Okay, so for example, let us assume that a table has two primary keys, A and B. Okay, now these two primary keys together determine the other attributes. Okay, so but what a partial dependency is, that when a part of a prime attribute, that is a candidate key, determines another non-prime attribute, then we call such a dependency as a partial dependency. So I told you what a prime attribute is. So what a non-prime attribute is basically, see, prime attributes are those attributes which are candidate keys. Now those attributes which are not candidate keys are known as non-prime attributes. Alright, so for example, if there are four attributes in a table, A, B, C, D, and if A and B are primary keys or the candidate keys, we say that A and B together is a prime attribute and C and D are non-prime attributes. Now, for example, to see how partial dependency works, we see this example. Now, Here, see the candidate keys here are inverse number and line number. Since as we can see that these are primary keys, so these become the candidate keys for this table. Now quantity and inverse, you know, inverse date, these are not the primary keys. These are the non-prime attributes. Okay. Now here we can see that inverse number and line number, they together determine quantity and inverse date. Okay. And only one of the attributes, that is inverse number, single-handedly determines inverse date. Now this is what a partial dependency is. See, partial dependency is basically when one part, that is inverse number of a part of prime attribute, a prime attribute is inverse number and line number together. Now inverse number alone is determining inverse date. So this is known as partial dependency. So what we try to do in second normal form is we try to remove the partial dependencies in databases. Okay, because this is not correct. Only one part of a prime attribute cannot single-handedly determine the other attributes. Okay, so this we'll understand this through the example that we see in the forthcoming slides. Now we need to understand why we decompose first normal form to second normal form. Okay, so as I said earlier, the major issue in first normal form is there might be partial dependencies still present in first normal form. Okay, so and when you remove these partial dependencies, the table enters into second normal form. So you right now you know what a partial dependency is. Okay, and now we'll be seeing examples that how a table in first normal form is converted into a second normal form. Okay, so now when do we see that a table is in second normal form? Well, it must satisfy two conditions. The first condition is it must be in first normal form. Okay, so now there's a hierarchy. So a table has to be, if a table is in second normal form, it has to be first in first normal form. And then the second condition here is it must be independent of all partial dependencies. That is, there should not be any partial dependency be present. So here we see an example. So for example, R is a relation where we have four attributes A, B, C and D. So such that AB determines D and B alone determines C. Now see, since B alone, AB together are prime attributes because these are the primary keys, and these two attributes together determine D. Alright, and B alone determines C. So a part of the prime attribute is determining a non-prime attribute. So this is where partial dependencies exist, and this is what we need to remove. So the first step here is let's calculate the AB closure. Okay, we are calculating the AB closure because A and B are prime attributes, and AB is a prime attribute. Yeah. So we calculate the AB closure. Now the AB closure is ABCD. This is because AB will determine AB. Then B determines C, so we get ABC, and AB together determines D, so we get ABC and D. Okay, and here AB is the candidate key. So now if we find only for B to check if to show how partial dependencies are present, now if we calculate the closure for only for B, B determines B and then B also determines C, so B determines BC. So the closure of B is BC. Here we are not getting the entire set of attributes, that is ABCD, when we take out the closure of B. Therefore we can see that B is not a candidate key. It is not a prime attribute. Here what it means is B alone is not a prime attribute. B together with A is a prime attribute. Okay, so B determines C, that is shown here, is a partial dependency, since B is only a part of the candidate key AB and not a candidate key itself. So normalization into second normal form. So how we normalize is basically this was the given relation. So now we need to remove the partial dependencies. So we remove the partial dependencies by doing this. We create two other relations, R1 and R2. Now R1 is ABD, like A and B together determines D as it was present here. Okay, and the second relation is B determines C. Now we see if these two attributes satisfy the first normal form condition and the partial dependency condition. Okay, see, these will be in first normal form because it is clearly seen that there's no repetition of attributes. We are assuming that there are no repetition of attributes. And the second condition here is to see partial dependencies. See here AB, if we take out the closure of AB in relation R1, it will give us ABD. Okay, so it is determining all the attributes. The prime attribute is determining all the remaining attributes. If we see in relation 2, here B acts as a primary key. It acts as a prime attribute and it determines C. And there are no other partial dependencies present. Okay, because it is the only primary key present in this relation. Thus, we can say that we have normalized the table into a second normal form. So here we see another example that I've taken out from some textbook. It's a two normal form example, 2NF example. Okay, so we see this table. So here we have four attributes: student, course ID, grade, and address. Okay, so now on careful evaluation, you know, of these, we see that a particular student, Eric, has a particular course ID and a particular grade. Okay, but this student here, Hilda, he also has the same grade. Okay, and the course ID here. So what we can say that these grade don't only depend upon the first name, they also depend upon the course ID. So there are two things which grades are derived from, that is student and course ID together. Okay, but the addresses are unique for everyone. So we can assume here, or we can formulate that every student has a unique address. Okay, so basically this is of the form, suppose if we take student as A attribute, A, this has B, this has C, and this has D. AB together is determining C, and A alone is determining D. So there's a partial dependency here, and we remove this partial dependency and normalize this table into a second normal form table. So here we have two tables, student and address. So student and address, basically every student has a unique address, so that's why now this table is in second normal form, because there are no partial dependencies. And similarly, this table, that is student, course ID, and grade, this is also in second normal form, because these two are the prime attributes, and they together determine the non-prime attribute, that is grade, and there are no partial dependencies present in this table. All right, so now we move on to the next form. The next form is the third normal form, or the 3NF. Okay, so we need to understand why we apply the 3NF and how is it different from the 2NF. Now, we apply 3NF to remove transitive dependencies from a table. Okay, so what is a transitive dependency? So basically, a transitive dependency is, so for example, let us consider three attributes, A, B, and C, where A determines B and B determines C. Now, this condition, A determines B and B determines C, is another transitive dependency. So from here, can't we assume that A determines B and B determines C? So A determines C. So this might be a good assumption for us. So thus we can say that functional dependencies are transitive, which means that we also have the functional dependency A tends to C, as I said earlier. So we say that C is transitively dependent on A through B. Okay, so here we have another example of transitive dependency. So for example, this is the first table that we have, where we have employee number, employee email, department number, department name. Okay, and the department number is determining the department name. So it is very evident from this table that the first attribute determines the next two attributes, and the third attribute determines the fourth attribute. Now here, the only primary key here in the table is employee number. So employee number is the only prime attribute we have in the table. So basically, employee number, that is the prime attribute, should determine all the other attributes. That is the rule. Every prime attribute should determine all the other remaining attributes, or all the other non-prime attributes. But in this case, what happens is employee number is determining employee email and department number, and department number in turn is determining department name. Okay, so this is not correct. So we need to change this transitive dependency. Okay, so now this is the representation showing that how we can say that employee number is determining department name also. Because see, we had seen in the last slide that if A determines B and B determines C, we can say that A determines C. Okay, so here employee number is determining department number, and department number is determining department name. So I can say that employee number is thus determining department name. Okay, so department name is transitively dependent on employee number by department number. Now, so why do we convert from second normal form to third normal form? Okay, so as I said, as I repeated before, I will say it once more. See, here AB, for example, if you see this example where we have a relation R and where we have four attributes A, B, C, and D. If we take AB are the prime attributes, as we can see through this arrow representation, and C and D are non-prime attributes. Okay, so now if we take out the closure of AB, we get A, B, C, D. That is the entire set of attributes. So thus we can clearly say that AB is a candidate key, and A and B together is a prime attribute. Okay, so this is clearly evident. And C and D are non-prime attributes because, for example, if we take out the closure of C or the closure of D, we won't get the entire set of attributes. Thus, we can say that C and D are not prime attributes. Alright, now, here AB is a candidate key, So it is supposed to find out the value of both C and D. As I said, if AB is a primary key, if it's a prime attribute, it is supposed to find out the values of all the remaining attributes. Okay. So AB being a prime attribute can together never be null. But C is a non-prime attribute and can thus be null. So this can thus cause a problem. So this is where the problem arises. For example, if AB will surely determine C, but what if C is 0? What if the value of C is null? See, value of, since A and B are prime attributes, the value of A and B can never be null together. Okay, but the value of C being a non-prime attribute can be null. And if the value of C is null, we can't determine D. We can't move forward, right? So this is where the problem lies. So now what we do is we break the table into two parts. For example, this, we normalize a 2NF table into a 3NF table. Okay, so on normalization we see that we break the relation R into two relations, R1 and R2. So here R1 has three attributes A, B and C, and R2 has two attributes C determines D. Okay, now here this is the prime attribute. A and B are the prime attributes and they together determine C. Okay, now in table 2, C becomes the prime attribute because it determines D. Okay, and C closure will give CD, that is the two attributes here. So now we need to understand that a table is in third normal form when, number one, it is in first normal form, number two, it is in second normal form, that is there are no partial dependencies, and number three, when there is no transitive dependency. So these three things should be present. Okay, so as we can see, there is no partial dependency present here. Okay, because not a single part of a prime attribute is determining the other attribute. So there's no partial dependency present here. And thirdly, we have removed the transitive dependency in this part. And thus this table, we can say, is in third normal form. So we see another example of a third normal form, which I've taken from a book. Okay, so here basically we have a table, student course ID, grade and grade value. And we are normalizing it into a third normal form. Now obviously see, every grade has a particular grade value. Like A has a grade value of 4, so which remains constant throughout. B has a grade value of 3 and C has a grade value of 2. So what we see here is these two columns, that is student and course ID, they together determine grade, and grade in turn determines grade value. Okay, so this is clearly an example of transitive dependency, and thus this is not in third normal form. Alright, so now we change this table into a third normal form table. So this is how we change it. We have a table where we have student, course ID and grade in one table, and we have another table with attributes grade and grade value. Okay, so now it is so clearly evident that if there's a grade A, then the grade value will be 4. If there's a grade B, the grade value will be 3. If there's a grade C, then the grade value will be 2. So we see that here we had 4 columns in the table, but here in this, sorry, 4 rows here, but here in this table, we only have 3 rows. So we are actually reducing the number of, you know, the number of redundancy or the number of tables. So for example, if there's a large database where there are more than, you know, 100 or 1000 items, so there might be repetitions of the same thing. So this is where normalization is used, when we have to compress a large amount of redundant data into small forms. Okay, so this is where we use it. Now, next part. The next part is the Boyce Quad Normal Form or the BCNF. Okay, so this is a very important part. Now see, a relational schema R is in Boyce Quad Normal Form or BCNF if whenever a functional dependency X tends to A, X determines A holds in R, then X is a super key of R. Then X should be a super key of R. So now here R is the relation. Okay. And suppose if X is an attribute which determines another attribute A. If such is the case, then X must be a super key of R. So we'll understand this in the forthcoming slides in a better way. So basically, informally saying, everything depends on the full key and nothing but the key. Okay, so what it means is all the attributes must be determined completely through the key. Okay, if we say it formally, we can say it that for every functional dependency A tending to B in F, you know, in closure of F, if A determines B is trivial, that is A is a superset of B, or A is a super key, or both. These are the three conditions which determine the which tell us whether a functional dependency or whether attributes in a table are in Boyce Quad Normal Form or not. We'll understand this concept in the next slide through better examples. Okay, so first let us discuss like 3NF versus BCNF. Okay, what is the difference? Okay, now you need to understand that BCNF is is of higher priority than 3NF. Okay, if a relation is in BCNF, it will always be in 3NF. Okay, but the converse is not true. If a table is in BCNF, it is not necessary that it will be in 3NF. Okay, so in practices, all the big companies, all the organizations, major organizations, they aim for BCNF, BCNF, 3NF, 4NF, all these higher forms. This is because this reduces a lot of redundancy from their data, okay, and it compacts their data. Alright, although the number of tables increases, but each table determines completely a particular set of attributes. Okay, that's very important. So now we see an example of BCNF. So for example, if there's a relation R, okay, and there are three attributes A, B and C. Now if A and B together determine C, okay, so we can see that AB is obviously the prime attribute. We have proved it here through taking out the closure of AB. Okay, that is ABC. Alright. And if we take out the closure of AC now, what happens is, if we take out the closure of AC, then AC also gives ABC, because see, A here determines C. Okay, so the closure of AC will be A, and then A determines C, so AC, and then C determines B, so ABC again. Alright. So now here, should we consider AC as the candidate key? Yes, we can consider it as a candidate key, although it is not a prime attribute. It is not a primary key. Alright. Now what BCNF says is that if there is a dependency of the form, suppose from alpha to beta there is a dependency where alpha is a prime or a non-prime attribute. Alright. Your P means prime and NP means non-prime, and beta is a prime attribute, then alpha should be a super key. What do I mean by super key is that alpha, the closure of alpha should be able to determine all the attributes present in the table. That is what a super key is. A super key should be able to determine all the attributes present in the table. Alright. So for example, if you see this table R, A, B, C, your alpha is prime or non-prime. Okay, it can be prime or non-prime. So here C, if we take C, C is a non-prime attribute. Alright. But it is determining B. Okay, so now it is determining B, and B is a prime attribute. Okay, now this is a part where there's a problem. See, if B is already prime attribute, it is able to determine all the other attributes. Okay, so it does not have to be determined by other attributes. So if B is already a prime attribute, it should determine the other attributes, and there's no need for other attributes to determine B. So here is where a redundancy is present, and BCNF tries to remove this redundancy. Okay, now for example, if we take the closure of C will only give us B. Okay, and it won't give us A. So the closure of C doesn't give us the entire set of attributes. So we can say that C is not a super key. So this condition fails. Okay, so now since this condition is failing, what we do is we break the table into two types of relations. The first relation will be R1, where A determines C, and the other relation will be where C determines B. Okay. So now we see this relation. I made a mistake in the previous slide where AB determines C. The actual relation should be R1, R2, where A determines C and then C determines B. There's no need of writing AB determines C because C is already determining B. So we don't need AB to determine C together. We can only have A determining C. So we don't need the second attribute to determine the third attribute. So here we show it in the correct form. R1 and R2, we break the table into two parts, R1 and R2. So R1 is basically A determines C and R2 is C determines B. Now see, here BCNF has to be in first normal form, it has to be in second normal form, it has to be in third normal form, and then these conditions should satisfy. Alpha should be a super key when alpha, being a prime or non-prime attribute, is determining a prime attribute. Alright, so now here we see that we are assuming that the tables are in first normal form. Okay, for second normal form, we need to check that there should be no partial dependencies. So this table has no partial dependencies because AB together is a prime attribute, and not a single part of a prime attribute is determining the other the non-prime attributes or the other attributes. So this table is not in second normal form. This table is already in second normal form. Sorry, the third part is it should not have transitive dependencies. So this table obviously doesn't have transitive dependencies because AB. There are three attributes and AB together is determining C, and there's like C is not determining any other fourth attribute. It is determining B but not a fourth attribute. Alright, so there's no transitive dependency in this table. And fourth is here we remove the BCNF, here we remove this dependency, that is alpha should be a super key. So we form the two tables, and now this is normalized to a BCNF form. Okay, so now A determines C, A is the prime attribute, and another prime attribute is determining the second prime attribute, that is B. So now we can see that since C is determining B, C becomes a prime attribute, and C is a super key of this relation. C is a super key of this relation, therefore it satisfies this condition where alpha prime or non-prime determines beta prime and alpha is a super key. So here this condition is clearly satisfied by this relation R2. Thus we can say that this table is finally finally normalized into a BCNF. Okay, so here we see another example of BCNF. So see, this table is in third normal form. It is in third normal form because there are no transitive dependencies in this table. Okay, but this table is not in BCNF. Now why is it not in BCNF? See, student number and course number, they together determine instruction number. Okay, but instruction number in turn is determining course number. Now this is of the form, see, since student number and course number are already prime attributes, they are the candidate keys, or we can say they are the prime attributes, so they don't need to be determined by some other attribute, because the role of the prime attributes is to determine other attributes. It should not be determined by other attributes. Alright, so instruction number it is not required for instruction number to determine course number. Alright, so here is what the table basically is, that instructor teaches one course only, student takes a course and has one instructor. This is what the basic table design is. So here we have written down the dependencies. Here student number and course number, they determine instructor number, and instructor number determines the course number. Okay, so see, obviously instructor number is not a candidate key, because if we take the closure of instructor number, it only determines course number and instructor number. It can't determine student number. So it is clear that this is not a candidate key. Okay, so we need to break a table in such a way that instruction number becomes a super key. Instruction number determines course number, and instruction number is the super key. So here is how we break the table. So student number, course number, instruction number. We break the table into two parts. Let's take it at relation R1 and relation R2. So the first relation R1 has two parts, student number and instructor number. So student number is already a prime attribute, it is determining another prime attribute. Okay, so not a problem. Okay, the second part is course number determining instruction number. Now the course number here, so the course number and the instructor number. Now the instructor number is the prime attribute here. Alright, and instructor number is determining the course number. Okay, so this table is normalized into a BCNF. Okay, so now there are more normalization paths called 4NF, 5NF. Okay, which requires your better understanding. So let's have a recap of whatever we did throughout this PPT. So first we learnt what normalization is and why we do normalization. Normalization is basically to remove redundancies from a table, you know, to ensure that there's no loss of information from a database. Okay, and normalization has various forms. For example, there's first normal form, second normal form, third normal form, BCNF, fourth normal form, fifth normal form. So as and when we keep moving down from first normal form to the, you know, the lower, to the more important normal forms, the number of tables keep increasing. Okay, but the redundancies or the loss of information keeps reducing a lot. So the information loss, redundancy, these are some of the important factors for any organization that deals in relational databases. So these information should not be lost. Okay, next we discuss what a first normal form is. So first normal form is basically, it should not have multiple values. Each cell should have only one single value. That is first normal form. Then we discussed, for example, every column in a first normal form must have the same type of data. Okay, so we took an example where there was units were LB and KG in the same table. So we divided them into two parts, where one was only LB and the other was only KG. Okay, the second thing that we learned was second normal form. So second normal form, there should not be any partial dependencies. What are partial dependencies? Partial dependencies are basically where one part of a prime attribute is determining a non-prime attribute. Okay, this is partial dependency. So we remove such type of partial dependencies in second normal form. In third normal form, what we do is, in third normal form, we remove the transitive dependencies. So what is a transitive dependency? If A determines B and B determines C, then this is a transitive dependency, and we can say that A determines C directly. Okay, so we break the table into, we break the relation into parts such that it forms the third normal form. What we learn in BCNF is that basically if there are two attributes, if there's a attribute, for example A, which can be prime or non-prime, determines another attribute B, which is non-prime, then A should be a super key. This is the main condition, that A should be a super key. Okay, so see, if a prime attribute is determining another prime attribute, then there's no problem. Okay, but if a non-prime attribute is determining a prime attribute, then there's an issue. So BCNF is used to remove that problem. Okay, a non-prime attribute should not determine a prime attribute. It should be the opposite. A prime attribute should be determining the non-prime attribute. So obviously we also discussed what a prime attribute and non-prime attribute is. So just to recap, a prime attribute is one. A prime attribute is basically a candidate key. Okay, it is basically a candidate key. A combination of primary keys will be a prime attribute. If a table has only a single primary key, then that will be the prime attribute of that table. Okay, and if a table has more than one primary key, for example, if a table has two primary keys, as we can see in this example, then those two primary keys together will form one prime attribute. Okay, and all those attributes which are not prime attributes or which are not candidate keys are the non-prime attributes. Alright, so I hope you all like this video. Thank you.